On today's episode of You Asked, it's all about OLED, including what to do if you want an OLED TV but live in a high humidity environment. Can frickin' laser beams destroy your OLED TV? And also, how could that even happen? And is this the year I almost universally tell people it's time to upgrade their OLED TV? Welcome back, everyone. I'm Caleb Dennison, and this is You Asked, the show in which I answer questions you asked in hopes that I can help you and others with similar tech questions. If you've got a question you need answered, please email it to youasked@digitaltrends.com and tune in Sundays at 7:45 a.m. Pacific time to see if your question gets picked to be answered on the show. We have one coming in from our island knit nerd, Ohana, Sean, who writes, Aloha, Caleb. I recently purchased a G4. That's an LG G4 OLED, but I didn't consider humidity. Like a lot of older homes on Oahu, my house doesn't have AC. Should I be very concerned about the humid air in my house for my OLED's longevity? And would it be worth buying a dehumidifier for it? Aloha, Sean. First off, and I suppose anyone who saw my Golden Ear T66 speaker review may know a little bit about this already, but I have a lot of family ties to Oahu. My father's parents served at Pearl Harbor. My grandmother was one of the military's first female aircraft mechanics. My dad was born there, and my grandfather is resting at Punchbowl Cemetery, more properly known as the National Memorial Cemetery of the Pacific. I almost couldn't get that out. Anyway, I've spent a good amount of time in the islands and on cruise ships in very high humidity environments, and I'm telling you all who are watching, if you haven't experienced real humidity or have even been away from it for just a couple of years, you forget. I mean, you might have memories, but your body forgets, and humidity can be a real problem, not just for people, but for all organic things. And that includes organic light emitting diodes, which is exactly what OLED TVs use to make a picture. Now, humidity is not great for electronics in general, so already we're starting at a disadvantage, but OLED compounds are organic and they degrade faster in high humidity environments, not just because of the moisture, but because of the accelerated oxidation and therefore degradation that takes place in those environments. Look, an OLED TV is not gonna die right away. You won't notice a problem within a year. I don't think you'd probably see a problem within 2 years. But after that, no guarantees, because even though you may not see the issues right away, the chemical breakdown is happening at a faster level than it would in a lower humidity environment. Now, I'm not just making this up. I may not be a scientist myself, but there are scientific papers published on this. Three Indian scientists published an extensive report about the effect of high humidity on OLED displays in the Journal of Electronics and Communication Engineering. So yes, if you live in a high humidity environment and don't have climate control that regulates the humidity for the area in which the OLED TV is to be placed, then you should probably get a dehumidifier. So get one, Sean. It's a smart investment, I think. And as a bonus, though you don't have AC in that room, the room in which that OLED TV is gonna reside is gonna feel a bit cooler, even if the temp is the same as an adjacent, more humid room. Now, it is also true that high heat can negatively impact OLED displays, but we're talking about long-term exposure to high direct heat. That's one of the many reasons that putting an OLED outdoors is generally a bad idea. Direct sunlight, even on a mild day outdoors, can damage an OLED panel. Don't worry about the heat in your home being a problem so much. The OLED's not gonna hurt unless you're hurting yourself from the heat in the home. So long as the heat isn't too high for too long, you're probably gonna be fine. Direct sunlight for too long, though, just ain't great. But most OLEDs won't get a lot of that inside a home as the sun tends to move throughout the day. Here's another OLED safety question coming from Paolo, who writes, hey Caleb, would a 6,000 lumen long throw laser projector directed at a motorized perforated screen pose any risk of damage to a Sony A95K QD OLED TV immediately behind it? Unsurprisingly, dots of light spill onto the panel while the projector and screen are in use, but then it's completely bathed in projection light when the motorized screen isn't fully raised up, usually for under 30 seconds. Okay, so I have to be super careful here. I wanna say that I will not be held liable should anything happen to your OLED TV, as I have not taken measurements and don't have hard data to support my theory. However, with that clearly disclosed, Just sharing my theory and opinion here, I highly doubt your OLED TV is at risk for any kind of damage. And here's why I think that. First, the laser light source in your projector is rated not to exceed 250 milliwatts. Now, I believe that these labels can sometimes be inaccurate, but I think we're in the safety zone, even if the projector has a class 3 rating associated with that warning sticker. Second, if the projector is a single laser projector, then it's a blue laser with a phosphor mounted over it so that it can project a very pure white light. That phosphor makes the light source diffused right away. If it's a 3-laser projector, that power is being spread out among red, green, and blue light sources, meaning not all of that laser power is going out at full strength all the time, unless it's to make white, and even then I'm not worried because third, the light gets scattered a lot, both in the projector and as it travels towards your screen. That means that light beam is going to be fairly weak at any given single point on your OLED screen by the time it gets there, and it's only happening for 30 seconds or less anyway. And then, by the time your projector screen is up, those pinpoints of light that are getting through the perforations are really, really super weak. So in short, no, I'm not worried about it. I think a 5-milliwatt laser pointer at point blank range isn't gonna cause damage. So the likelihood that your projector is gonna do damage is slim to none. Now, if we have any credentialed scientists or engineers out there who know better than I, please weigh in down in the comment section. Amar writes, "Hi Caleb, we bought an LG C1 OLED TV a couple of years ago, which we are very happy with, and your reviews were very helpful in making that decision. Because of this positive experience, I'm thinking of buying the upcoming LG G5 OLED TV for my parents. However, both TVs will be close to each other, and that could mean one remote might accidentally signal both TVs. Is this possible? And should I consider buying another brand such as Samsung or Sony to avoid this issue? What surprised me was that when I researched this issue, there was a lack of consistent and simple information." Hey Amar, so you are actually correct to anticipate this potential problem. I experience it here in the studio all the time. In fact, recently I had the TCL QM6K set up and I pressed the power button on the remote and the QM891G, the 110 inch monster over here, lit the room up like it was the holidays in February. So many remotes pair to their televisions via Bluetooth as part of the setup process, and some commands are executed only over Bluetooth. This includes LG OLED TV remotes. However, most remotes have basic functions operating via infrared still, most notably the power button. And some remotes will enable many functions over infrared and Bluetooth as a backup. The idea being, if you go out of line of sight, you can still control the basics of a TV even when the infrared signal can't reach the TV's infrared eye. Now, I think the biggest problem most people in your situation are gonna have is when you're powering the TV on. You may want one TV to turn on, but not the other. Now, I can also hope that if the TVs are really close together and running at the same time, that you're probably gonna be watching the same programming on each. Regardless, the best solution I know is to shield the remote's infrared signal from the TV that you do not want it operating. This is because infrared signals are very basic and most manufacturers do not modulate them year to year. So the power button on a remote for a C1 is very likely to be the same IR code as the power button for a C4 or a C5 or a G4 or a G5. Even if the remote looks different and has different buttons on it. So the best solution I have found is to shield the TV I do not want turning on or otherwise being controlled from the remote signal. To do this, well, let me just show you with this remote I have here. If the TV I want to turn on is right in front of me, that would be you in this case, and the TV I do not want to turn on is off to my left, your right, as you're watching this, I'll hold my hand like this in front of the remote to shield the infrared signal coming out of it. Think of it as like a beam of light from getting to this TV's infrared eye. This works in my space. I can do the opposite too. I can turn toward the TV over here, hold my hand as such by the remote to shield the beam of light from the TV I don't want to be turned on, and I'm usually okay. Now, is this a high-tech, clever, sexy, convenient way to handle the problem? Absolutely not. But it does work, and I don't know of any better solution. Probably because this is a problem that not many folks run into that often, so it's kind of a tough problem to solve for when not that many people actually have it. Now, to your question, is it worth getting a different TV brand just to avoid this one issue? I'm gonna have to leave that up to you. I suppose the question that I would pose is, which is less convenient? Shielding the remote signal from one TV of the two, which are the same brand, or having to use a different style of remote and get used to a different on-screen interface by using two different TV brands? I mean, if only your parents are using the other TV and you are only using this one TV and you never cross over, well then maybe it's not a big deal to you to have two different TV brands. Either way, good luck, and if you think to, let us know what you end up deciding to do. Jan from Slovakia writes, I still love my old Panasonic GZ950 OLED TV from 2019. Jan, that's not that old. But this year, I finally decided to upgrade. I'm considering the LG C4 or even C5. Will I see a significant upgrade in picture quality, or do I have to aim for the flagship models? I'm also worried about motion processing and color handling since I hate the soap opera effect, and Panasonic handles this perfectly. And also, it has a strange, special film-like feel that I like, which I struggle to see in other brands. Hey Jan, I'll admit, this is a tough one. The LG C5 would be notably brighter than the Panasonic that you have, as it's noticeably brighter than the LG C4 even. The LG C4 may be a bit brighter than your GZ950, but not by a huge amount. I think your Panasonic was tested to produce up to 700 nits in a 10% window and about 165 nits full screen white. The LG C4, I wanna say, did about 800 nits, 10%, and maybe slightly higher full screen. Now, while the LG C4 did do 1,000 nits in smaller, tiny areas of the screen, the LG C5 can do 1,000 nits at a 10% window, indicating it is brighter. And I haven't tested it yet, but I think it's gonna do higher brightness full field white than the LG C4. It's gonna be brighter overall, especially for SDR content. LG did say the C5 sees a bit of a brightness boost compared to prior years, which is why I was so excited about it in my recent LG video that went up. All that said, Panasonic's processing is pretty special, I agree. I like LG's processing very much. It's come a long, long way, and it can look very cinematic. However, the best processing LG reserves for the G series. So yeah, I can see an argument to go for the LG G series. I gotta ask though, why not consider another Panasonic OLED? Are they not available in your area any longer? Because I think the Z85 would work really well for you. At any rate, is there gonna be a significant uptick in picture quality between what you have now and the LG C4? Not so much with the C4, although it will be better in some ways. The C5, yeah, I think you probably notice an appreciable difference. It just won't have that Panasonic look to it. Also, remember, this all depends on how sensitive you are. And I can't determine whether you're gonna find it significant based on your sensitivity, because I don't know anything about that. I would say, really, unless you're unhappy with your current TV, maybe just don't replace it. There's gonna be fun, fancy new TV tech to buy into no matter when it is the right time to buy for you. And remember, your OLED TV is awesome already. It can only get more awesome in small increments. Mark O'Hara writes, I have just purchased an LG G4 OLED upgrading from an LG C2 OLED. The picture quality is night and day difference, but I'm having difficulty finding the sweet spot for picture settings. I typically like a bright and cool type of picture and usually have used the Vivid preset on my C2 and other TVs in my home. The Vivid setting is the closest to what I like for the G4, but almost seems like the brightness is too much and washes out the color, accuracy, and detail. I see a lot of people rave about filmmaker mode, but that setting is just much too dim for my liking. Any advice on which picture settings on Vivid mode to adjust to fix this issue for me, or any other recommendations? Also, should I be enabling settings like AI Picture Pro? Thanks for your question, Mark. And before I answer it, I would like to request that any TV enthusiast purists out there, please be kind. I can see lots of you saying not nice things in the comments already. And hey, folks like what they like. Some folks don't want accurate, and they don't want accurate at the expense of brightness, which is why some folks like the Vivid mode. If people didn't like Vivid mode, then TV brands wouldn't put one in the TV. They'd have a store mode preset and just call it good. Now, Mark, yeah, the reason it looks washed out is because it is washed out. You have two things going on, and you can address them both yourself if you want. One is that the TV is maxing out that white subpixel in your G4 to the point that it is literally washing out the color to get you that white brightness boost. Also, the blue color channel in the RGB balance that makes white is juiced way, way, way too high. So I would say that you can do two things. One, select Vivid, but back down the brightness setting a bit so it isn't as washed out. That TV is just going too far with the brightness for you. You're not gonna lose all the advantages of that TV by backing down the brightness setting a little bit. And I normally don't tell people to adjust the white balance in their TVs without being able to measure the results of what they're doing, but you may find it easier on the eyes if you back down the blue channel in the 2-point white balance adjustments for the gain section. Not bias, gain is at the high powerful side, bias is at the low luminance side. So back down the blue a bit in the gain. Now, you aren't gonna meaningfully throw the other colors off because they are already about as off as they possibly can be. Backing down the blue will make it a little easier on the eyes. I would start with small adjustments and keep backing it down until you feel it's easier to watch. Start with the brightness setting first, though. That's it for this week's episode, everyone. Thank you so much for watching, and thanks for the amazing comments. Keep them coming. Click that thumbs up button if you like this particular video. If this is your first time here, subscribe so you never miss any of our videos. I'll see you on the next one, and until then, here's two other videos I think you might like. Close together and running at the same... That is our outtake.